We are the body of Christ. In the one Spirit, we are baptized into one body. Let us then pursue all that makes for peace and builds up our common life. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Good morning. Welcome to morning worship at Emmanuel United Church, both here seated in the sanctuary and those who are with us online. My name is Tom Watson. I'm from Guelph. I'm pleased to be with you this Sunday. I have never had the privilege of being in this sanctuary before. So what a pleasure it is to be here. I'm assuming that this was a Methodist church. It was what? Oh, it was EUB, eh, Mary? And they joined the United Church in 68, was it? Something like that? 69, somewhere in that area? Yeah. Oh, interesting. Thank you very much. What a rich history you have. What a rich history. Our call to worship. The mists of the morning hang thick. And then the slowly rising sun burns through.
And the world is jeweled with light.
Praise be for the morning.
Praise be for the morning of this day.
Our opening hymn, Morning Has Broken.
Let us pray together. Creator God, we give thanks for this day and for all the days of our lives. Bring newness to birth within us. Open our timid places to the gift of courage. Fill our souls with hope. Amen. I have a paraphrase of Psalm 23 that we're going to read responsively The Lord is my shepherd.
He leads me through different kinds of places.
But in all these places, God is there.
He's enough.
The first place he took me was called Green Pastures.
Within it, we found quiet waters.
We got there along the paths of righteousness.
And he taught me all the way.
This is for lying down in.
This is for drinking.
This is for walking along in order to get there. And then one day the paths of righteousness led through the dark valley.
On the way to
I did not like dark valley. It did not look like green pastures. It did not smell like quiet waters.
I could not believe the paths of righteousness would go through there.
But when my shepherd and I started out, I realized the dark valley had one good thing about it.
He was there.
That good thing stayed with me the whole way through.
Because of that, I wasn't too scared to go on.
I asked him where the paths of righteousness finally led to.
He said that it led to Father's house.
I asked why the path we took to get there was so winding.
He said everything was to prepare me for life in Father's house.
I asked him if we were ever going to stop traveling.
He said when we got to the Father's house, to stay there forever.
Thank you.
What happened? What happened? I thought I did something up there and I wondered what it was. How are you? You're good? You're good? Now, who's gone back to school this week? Not yet. You have too? He's starting for the first time. Ah, how you like it? Fine? Great. You're in kindergarten. And you're in?
Grade five.
Grade five. Wow. Wow. I was going to ask you, and this could be for anybody, what's the biggest thing in the world you could think of? Yep. School is the biggest thing. Sure it is. That's one big thing. What else?
School.
He said school was the biggest thing he could think of. What else? Anybody?
Something.
What?
The sun.
The sun? And you said?
I was just going to say the CN Tower.
Oh, the CN Tower, sure. Or an elephant, or I don't know.
Mountain.
A mountain, sure.
The moon.
And what's the smallest thing in the world you can think of?
A mouse.
Mosquito.
I don't like them little fellas. They did that to me last
time. Oh.
Huh? An atom. Now we're getting to it.
An electron.
A molecule.
I don't know. Just think about the prion.
Now, I was thinking the smallest thing I could think of was a pimple on a flea's knee. Now, that might not be as small as a molecule. It might not be. Yeah, probably not. I did this one time with the group, and everybody gave the expected answers, except when I came to this one little girl, and she looked at me, and she said, this was for the biggest thing in the world. My mommy can't walk. And she would never walk again because she had developed a particular disease that made that she couldn't walk. And what could be bigger than that, right? So just some things to think about. Do you go off to Sunday school or do you stay here?
Yeah, we can.
Okay. Let's have a little prayer before we go. Okay. Gracious God, we thank you for big things, for small things, for school, for learning, for education, and for all of the joys of everyday life. Be with us in all those things. Amen. Thank you for being here. Jesus set out and went away to the region of Tyre. He entered a house and did not want anybody to know that he was there. Yet he could not escape notice. But a woman whose little daughter had an unclean spirit immediately heard about him, and she came and bowed down at his feet. Now, the woman was a Gentile of Syrophoenician origin, and she begged him to cast the demon out of her daughter. Jesus said to her, "Let the children be fed first, for it is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." But she answered him, "Sir, even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs." Then he said to her, "For saying that, you may go. The demon has left your daughter." So she went home, found the child lying on the bed, and the demon gone. Herein lies wisdom. The title of my sermon is "The Day the Gospel Went to the Dogs." And this story about Jesus' encounter with the Syrophoenician woman is so interesting, primarily because the conversation between them seems so out of character with the image we have of Jesus. Jesus, the one who welcomes everyone, no matter who they are, welcomes both saints and sinners. Jesus, the one who wants the children to come to him, even though the disciples are trying to shoo them away. Jesus, who seems to care not whether one is a Jew or a Gentile. Jesus, the one who made friends with lepers and prostitutes and even the hated Samaritans. Jesus, the one who reached out when nobody else would reach out. Jesus, the bringer of radical grace. Now, time out for a segue. Excuse me, it has to do with that phrase I just used, radical grace. One time back in the 1980s, when I was minister at Coburn Street United Church in Brantford, the title of my sermon was "When Radical Grace Comes to Town." I'm not sure what the scripture passage was that I based that sermon title on, but that was the title, "When Radical Grace Comes to Town." Janice's mother was visiting us for a week and came to church that Sunday, and I couldn't help but notice that she looked sour. Just sat there, not smiling, sour, sulking. And I wondered why, and then it occurred to me, she opened the bulletin, took one look at the sermon title, "When Radical Grace Came to Town," and that set her off. Guess what her name was? Yep, Grace, there in bold print, Radical Grace. She might as well have gotten up and headed home because the service was already lost on her. There's a saying that the road to hell is paved with good intentions. And that day I learned that the road to hell is paved with sermon titles. No matter how well-intentioned, they can be toxic. In any event, we can leave that segue now and come back to the story. Jesus and his disciples have come to the region of Tyre. They have come there because he wanted to get away from it all. he needed a timeout, and he didn't want anybody else to know he was there. And suddenly he's confronted with this Syrophoenician woman. She has a daughter who's possessed by an unclean spirit, and she wants Jesus to cast it out. In other stories that we have read, Jesus would have done that without even batting an eye. But in this case, he declines. Let the children be fed first, for it's not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs. In other words, get in line. There are some other priorities here. When all the right people have been looked after, we'll see about your daughter then. But the woman won't take no for an answer. She argues her case. Sir, even the dogs under the table eat the crumbs that the children drop. In other words, I know you think of us as dogs, but surely you have a little something left to spare, even for us dogs. And with that, Jesus relents and tells her to go home because her daughter has now been cured. So there's an interesting question to ask here. Just how wide do you draw the circle? Who's included? Who isn't? Who's welcome at the table and who isn't? Who are the children and who are the dogs? It was a Tuesday evening quite a few years ago, 10:30 in the evening, at the church. And our committee had been meeting for over 3 hours, and we still weren't finished our agenda. The main topic was to figure out how to help some of the people who had lost their jobs and were down on their luck. Things had not gone very smoothly from the very start of the evening because Mrs. Kirby showed up late, and she delayed everything by insisting upon talking about her trip to the Toronto Zoo that day and how much she loved watching the penguins. And even when we finally got into discussions, it seemed hard to get agreement on things. You know how it is sometimes? Time drags on and people get frustrated, tired, cranky. One major item still to go: how to help those families in their church, in our church, who had been having a tough time of it. Suddenly the bell on the office door rang, and the committee chair asked me to go and answer it, and at the door was a young man. "I need help," he said. "My wife and two children and I have been traveling since early morning, and we have no place to spend the night, and we have no money." I said, "I'm sorry, not much I can do to help you at this time of the night. Anyway, we're trying to finish up an important matter here at a meeting, so I got to get back to that and tell you what, if you're still in town in the morning, come and see me. We'll see what we can do then." And I closed the door, two steps back towards the meeting room, and the bell rang again, and I turned and opened it, and he was still there. "But I need help now," he said. "I need help now. Not tomorrow morning. Tonight. Now." And he sounded a bit irritated. So was I. "Didn't I tell you there isn't anything I can do to help you tonight?" I closed the door again. Two steps back, again towards the meeting room, and the bell rang a loud, steady ring. I stopped and I stood still. Maybe he'll go away if I don't go back to the door. And the bell rang 8 times. I opened the door. "Listen, listen, you have no right." "I know I have no right," he said. "I have no right to anything. But it's not a matter of right. I need help." And I stood there thinking. Because back there in our church committee, we were trying to figure out how to help some of our own people. And we're having trouble coming to grips with that. This man isn't one of our people. What do I do about it? Let the children be fed first. For it's not fair to take the children's bread and throw it to the dogs. And there the man stood. There he stood. Sir, even the children eat the crumbs. I'm sorry, even the dogs eat the crumbs that the children let fall from the table. There's another time I remember. I was at a meeting of a club I belonged to, and it was annual election time. And two people were running for president. One of them I liked. He was part of a little group that I was part of. And the other, well, he wasn't somebody I spent a whole bunch of time with. He was part of the group that sat, you know, over there on the other side of the room. Oh, I know, we're all part of the same club, but do you know how it goes? There are those you like and there's those you don't like. There are those who have ideas that are similar to yours, and there are those who have ideas that are quite different. And that fellow was from that other group. Actually, he was a pretty good candidate, but I wasn't sure he would support all the things I was interested in. We always had a time for devotions at the meetings of our club. And that evening, it was my turn to do devotions, and I remember reading from the book of James and mentioning that James says there are two problems that deny the core of the Christian gospel. Two problems that deny the core of the Christian gospel, and one is the neglect of human need, and the other is favoritism, overlooking the truth that before God, all people are equal. A lot of people said they appreciated the devotions that I made that night. And it came time to vote. Should I vote for the candidate from that other group? Or the candidate from my group? We were, after all, part of the same club, but did I mention that other candidate was tall? And I tend to favor short people. You know, just on principle, I guess. Rights and no rights. Who do we favor and who don't we favor? Who are our kind and who are not our kind? Are we all equal or not? We do have to keep straight, don't we? Who are the insiders and the outsiders? You remember Groucho Marx once said, I wouldn't belong to any club that would have me as a member? We do have to be somewhat exclusive, don't we? We got to be a little bit prejudiced sometimes, don't we? But then, as Jesus tried to point out time and again, no, we don't. And if that's the case, perhaps each of us could ask ourselves, what are the exclusivities and the prejudices that we need to grow beyond? It was at a place called Tyre. Jesus walks along, and suddenly this woman comes running up to him and bows down at his feet, and she says, my daughter is an unclean spirit. I beg you to come and heal her. But you see, this is a problem because she's a Phoenician. She's a Gentile. She has no business talking to a Jewish rabbi. That was the rule. The social gap between them is cavernous. It's like a bag lady trying to make an appointment to talk to Jeff Bezos, the owner of Amazon. There are rules about these things. Woman, I have enough of my own people to heal. First things first, you know. Besides, it just isn't right to take the bread away from the children and throw it to the dogs. She was one of the dogs and was a derogatory term used in that day to refer to Gentiles. But this woman does not allow the likening of herself to a scrounging dog. She doesn't let that deter her. In fact, she turns the words that Jesus said back on him and says, "But sir, I know I have no right to ask you to help." But that doesn't change the fact that even the dogs get to eat the crumbs that fall from the children's table. So just a few crumbs, just a few crumbs, if you will. That'll be enough for my daughter. And he did. He did. It was quite astounding, really. That day, Jesus gave the gospel away to the dogs. Another favoritism barrier broken down, another person included, another's faith recognized, another person who had absolutely no right to grace given grace, which incidentally is wonderfully significant for you and me, because it's a reminder that God's grace isn't something to be earned. It's always a gift. This Phoenician woman from Tyre seemed to know something that people of Jesus' time hadn't yet learned, and what many of us still haven't learned. There's absolutely nothing we can ever do to earn the grace of God. It's simply there. It's not a matter of having special rights or anything special about us at all. There are not two kinds of people, those who are our kind and that kind, worthy and unworthy. There are just people. Oh, I know we make up categories and we put other people in them. But those categories are ours, not God's. There aren't our people and other people. There are just people. There's no them and us. There's just us. And isn't it marvelous that when the crumbs of grace fall from the table, there's more than enough for even us, even for the likes of you and me. Amen. Our hymn, "Draw the Circle Wide, Draw It Wider Still."
Thank you.
There are some slides that are going to show about the various ways that we can give through our church, but Mary is going to bring forward the offering that has been. Oh, you got, all right, you go collect it first then, Mary. We'll just do something else while you're gone. Huh? Oh, Trudy's going to play something. I can just sit down. Gracious God, we thank you for these gifts that have been given. Bless them. Bless the other ways that we give of ourselves, the work of this church, the community, and this world. I want you to notice that the Emmanuel community is holding these people in prayer this week. Frank Abbott, the father of Lisa McKay, Ahilam and Jeremy, Trudy Day, Kathleen Lambert, friend of Mooksura's family, Tim and Liz Worth, Roz and Lynn Avon's neighbor, Laurie Scotch, am I saying that right? Sister of Murray Beck, and any others that you might know of that you want to hold in prayer, we will do that. But I have this responsive reading from A Litany of Hope that's adapted from the writings of Van Weems. I keep reaching for rainbows, thinking one God's morning I will wake up with rainbow ribbons in my hair.
The first world created in the myriad of colors.
The hungry fed, the dying held,
the lame walking, the angry stroked,
the violent calmed, the oppressed freed,
the oppressors changed, and every fear wiped away,
and every anxious nerve in me held and soothed.
I keep reaching for rainbows, for I know the promise of the rainbow.
I keep thinking I'll turn the corner one day and find the litany of rainbows.
Fly across the sky, singing hosannas back and forth through all the ages, and out into eternity forever.
tear wiped away. It's a promise.
The promise of the rainbow, the promise of God.
And it starts when we become rainbows to each other. There are lots of ways for us to become rainbows, and sometimes we're not really sure what we can do or what we should do, or because some doesn't it sometimes seem as if there is so much? Wars and rumors of wars, and this week my partner Julie and I went on a 3-day trip down to Niagara Falls and back, and we came through a part of Hamilton yesterday, and in a area of perhaps 5 blocks around a large Anglican church. I'm going to guess there were 250 homeless people. And it's sad. And we wonder, I mean, a society as rich as Canada, why? I don't have the answers, and I don't know what to do. I do know what bothers me. Yesterday morning when we were having breakfast at the hotel we stayed at in Stony Creek, the server said she was from Palestine. And I said to her, there's a lot of trouble there in Gaza. Yes, there's a war, and I have family there. And they tried to escape to Egypt, but Egypt shut the gates. And some days I think how fortunate I have been and am. Let us continue our prayers. Gracious God, help us to be rainbows in the places that we can be. We can't do everything. We can do some things. So help us to do those things. We hold prayers in our heart for people around us in the world who are hurting, perhaps a neighbor up the street, a friend, someone who has just received a serious diagnosis, somebody who is unsure of tomorrow. We hold them in the rainbows that lay in our hands, and we pray for hope and help and healing. All these prayers and those words we have not yet spoken, we lift up to you and continue to pray as we have been taught, saying, Our Mother and our Father, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You might remember singing our closing song back when you were young, maybe in Sunday school. Is often reported to have been written in the 1920s by Harry Dixon Lowes, specifically for children, but Lowes never claimed credit for the original version of this song. Truth is, its origin isn't known.
It remained popularity, gained popularity during the civil rights movement and was regularly used at African American churches. And it came to be sung around the world with simple lyrics and a simple tune resounding with all ages. Even though the lyrics are simple, they do have meaning. And it's a fun song to sing. So let's sing it. It's called This Little Light of Mine. May God go with us when we leave this time of worship. And may we let our light shine wherever we are.
This day, Lord.